Now I'd like to talk about the open discussion question posted in homework one. To review, Alice wants to send a message to Bob using a one-time pad to let Bob know yes or no if she's going to be taking CS387. And they're worried about Mallory, who could possibly intercept the message and then change around the message so that Bob would get the wrong message.
And we saw in the question that Mallory could, whatever she intercepts, she can't tell whether it's yes or no, but she can XOR it with the difference between yes and no. And that will flip the answer. And some of the suggested solutions were to change yes and no to other things, thinking there was something special about yes and no that those could be flipped. But you can flip anything, and you're flipping it by XORing it with the difference. Whatever was there was either yes or no XORed with some key. You don't know the key, but XORing that with the difference of them will cancel out the Y's, or if this was an N, it would cancel out the N's and leave the Y. So whatever message was, it can be XORed with a difference. There's nothing special about Y or N. It would work, let's say, if you replaced it with yes and not. The difference is just Mallory would XOR it with the XOR of yes and not. So all the solutions that were ideas about changing the content don't really solve anything. Mallory knows the two options, can XOR them, and can flip the content. There were some other approaches that had better success, though.
There was two main styles. For example, Steve Krenzel from Seattle suggested using kind of more advanced crypto tools. He wanted to append a nonce to the message and then hash the entire message.
Okay. So I think what he was suggesting, which is a good solution to this, is to take the yes or no, so you're still giving a response. You're going to concatenate that with a nonce, which is just some random value. We'll call it R. This is a long random value. And then concatenate that with a hash of the Y, whatever the answer was, with the nonce. And we haven't talked about hash functions yet in unit one, but we do talk about them in unit two. And a hash function is just a function that takes some input and maps it in a complex and unpredictable way to some other value. And that's useful because Bob can't predict what this value is without knowing what the value of R is. And if the value of R is random and not known to Bob, there's no way for Bob to predict the output of this hash. If he tries to change this, well, there's no way to change it in a way that knows the difference between what the result would be if this was an N and when it was a Y. So Bob could flip these bits, but then the hash value wouldn't be correct. And Mallory could flip these bits, then the hash value wouldn't be correct, and Bob would know that it was wrong. So this is a reasonable way to do it. The difficulty with the solution is, well, it involves cryptographic tools that are much more complex than just XOR. Hash functions are things we'll talk about in the next unit, but involve a fair amount of computation. It's not something you can easily do by hand. What we want is some solution that would allow Alice and Bob to do this without using any more advanced cryptographic tools.
Yeah, I guess the other style of solutions was one proposed by Stirkat, which involves sending a number of dashes, you know, maybe 8 or 16 just dashes in a row, and then randomly picking one character to set to Y or N. And then what are your thoughts on that?
Okay, so this is a really interesting idea. So we're going to take, instead of sending just one character, we've got a string of 8 dashes, and we're randomly going to pick one of those and replace it with either the Y or the N. That's going to be the answer. And now this means when Mallory intercepts it, if she doesn't know which one was randomly picked, well, she can XOR out the difference between a Y or N from any one of these 8. But if she picks the wrong one, she's going to change a dash into something else. And I don't know what it would be. We'd have to look at the numbers. But it's not going to be a dash anymore. And so when Bob looks at the result, it's going to look wrong. Bob will know the message was tampered with. It's only if Mallory was lucky enough to guess the right one to flip that she could change the answer. And her probability of guessing it correctly is 1 over the number of positions here. So if we have 8, she has a 1 in 8 chance of guessing the right one and flipping that one. The other times when she doesn't guess correctly, she'll get caught. So this is pretty good. This has a nice property. It means if we make a message long enough, we can make Mallory's success probability as low as we want. But we need a really long message. If we want her success to be less than 1 in 256, we need a string that's 256 bytes long, which not a big deal, but is less elegant. We could get a similar property with a shorter message, is if instead of having only one of them depend on the choice, we make a short message where each of the characters in the message depends on the yes or no value, but Alice randomly picks either to send a Y or a 1 if the answer is yes, or to send an N or a 0. So let's say those are the four choices. So she's going to randomly pick, if the answer is Y, she's going to send something like YY, 1Y, randomly picking for each position whether to send a Y or a 1. When Mallory intercepts this, the XOR between Y and N is different from the XOR between 1 and 0. Those two are not equal. So for Mallory to flip an answer, she's got to guess whether it was a Y or an N or a 1 or a 0. And she can guess and flip one. If she guesses them all correctly, well, then she could flip them all and Bob would see the wrong answer. But if she guesses one wrong, then Bob will see one of the characters in the string doesn't match. And so now Mallory's property, Mallory's probability of guessing them all correct is 1/2 to the power of how many there are. So if there were four characters, it'd be 1/2 to the fourth or 1/16. But this is a much lower success probability than we had having the string of dashes where Mallory only had to guess one position correctly out of that whole length. Now she's got to guess each position correctly with 1/2 chance for each time. So this just involves Alice picking randomly. So we did need to add something beyond the one-time pad. Alice has to be able to flip a coin or some other source of randomness to decide whether to send the Y or the 1 for each of these four positions or more positions if she wants the success probability to be lower than 1/2 to the 4.
Could you also do like a lowercase y and like a t for true and a lowercase t?
You could, yeah. So probably what you'd have to be careful about if you did a lowercase y and a lowercase n.
It's the difference.
The XOR of those might be the same as the difference between the uppercase y and the uppercase n. I would guess if you did true and false, those would be different, but you should be careful and know that the XOR is not the same. But as long as the XOR is different, then each byte, Mallory has just 1/2 chance of making it changed in the right way.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's all we have.
Cool. So thanks for joining Office Hours, and thanks for all the discussion. It looked like we got a lot of good responses to the open discussion questions, so hopefully we'll see that again in homework 2.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks.